Hey, you hot mamas! Welcome to Crazy Sexy Menopause. If you're new to my channel, I'm Betty Vargas, and I specialize in providing education, compassion, and welcomed relief to overwhelmed, overworked, and potentially overweight women before, during, and after menopause. If this is you, click the link in the description that will lead you to my website and get my free ebook, 3 Keys to Maximizing Life During Menopause. Today, I have a very special guest. Marianne Cresp is a content creator whose mission is to inspire you on your own planning journey. For those days when you feel a bit overwhelmed, she wants you to get those things out of your head and down on paper and to make time in your planner for the things that bring you joy. Marianne has 2 sons and a wonderful and supportive husband. She began homeschooling her youngest son, who is on the autism spectrum, in 2019, and turned to planning as a form of self-care and a coping tool to manage the anxiety that brewed trying to educate him herself. In 2021, Marianne started creating her own planner inserts to suit what she needed in her day-to-day planning. And through the encouragement and later requests from her followers on Instagram, a business was born. And Marianne is also perimenopausal. Welcome, Marianne.
Hello,
how are you?
I am wonderful. I appreciate you so much for having me on your show. I am very honored and I look forward to our conversation today.
Oh, it is such a pleasure to have you with me today. I have loved your content, and I mean, you know, and I've told you how cathartic it is, so you guys have to check it out. But first, let me just ask you, where are you on your menopause journey?
Now, Betty, I think it's because of you I know that I am actually, pardon me, that I am on a menopause or perimenopause journey. I didn't think I was. At 48, I'll be 49 in January.
Okay.
I thought, I'm not there yet. However, through our conversations and through, you know, me now not having air my period for nearly 3 months, I started to look up the things that are the symptoms involved with menopause and perimenopause. And lucky enough for me, being connected with you, I had all the details I needed to know. So I started binge watching your YouTube videos. So will I say then I am just at the start? I don't know much. However, I'm starting to learn a lot more.
Very good. Oh, listen, thank you so much for binge watching. I'm so humbled by that. I love it. But listen, what I've always wondered about this. What's been your experience being menopausal with sons and a husband? That's a lot of testosterone to handle. How's that been?
Well, I've just thought it was normal. I've always somehow knew, I don't know from where, but I thought when my husband, boyfriend at the time, well, first started going out, that when we did get married, that I would have 2 sons. So it's always been, I guess, in my cards. And I think they just, for me, it's just the normal thing. For them, that's probably just mum going crazy. I've been going crazy since my 30s. So I just thought maybe it's just my nature, my personality. But now I may actually be able to pinpoint that the things that are happening are due to perimenopause, which is great to have that answer and not just going, mom's going cuckoo this month.
Yes. And that's what a lot of women are thinking. They're thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going crazy. And that's just not it. You know, you have to start looking at those hormones. Well, Marianne, let me just say this. You have been blowing up the internet as the go-to resource for all kinds of creative tools and techniques related to planning, habit tracking, and journaling. And I've got loads of questions to ask you about all three, particularly related to how they can help women in menopause, because you're perimenopausal. You know exactly what's going on. But before we go there, tell us briefly about how planning and habit tracking inspired you to create your business.
Well, I call myself an accidental venture into entrepreneurship. As you mentioned earlier, I started homeschooling my son, and to be able to be organized with homeschooling as well as our home life, it's important that I was organized. Now, I've always loved using a diary, my elementary days, my dear diary. Did we have any, let us know in the comment section if you also had those dear diary moments. Dear diary, he doesn't like me. So I've always planned and journaled and used my dear diary moments, for those things, the good things that happen and the things not so good that happen. So I've always been a pen to paper kind of girl. And then in 2016, for those viewers that may not know, there's this thing called bullet journaling by Ryder Carroll is the one who first originated, where you just take a blank piece of notebook and you bullet point your to-do list. So I started doing that, and then, of course, embellishing the pages, because as a lover of stationery, I didn't realize back then washi tape, stickers, stationery, markers and highlighters is what brings me joy. And so I do embellish my planner pages. And I found only recently, because someone asked me, how do you find the time to put time into planning and making those pages pretty? Mm-hmm. I discovered it was my me time. It was my self-care time. And I think from speaking with you and knowing that the symptoms that's going to not only start coming up later on, but the ones that are coming up now, that planning has actually, I think, minimized, not taken away, but minimized some of those symptoms that are maybe going to come up with, whether it comes to the brain, your health, your physicality, has helped me put something in place. So I've created habits, I've created systems of organizing myself. And this is just through normal mum stuff, normal household stuff, normal house homeschooling things. But now I'm starting to realize I'm actually might be in a really good position to take this perimenopause journey head on.
Wonderful. I love it. I love it. That puts it in a completely different perspective, especially when women are, there's so much going on in their lives and there's so many things that are pulling them here and there and everywhere. So I love that you have looked at it as your me time. It's absolutely wonderful. So let's talk about planning. Mm-hmm. How does having a structured plan contribute to managing the cognitive changes that often accompany menopause?
So let us know, Betty, first, I guess, what sort of things would the cognitive symptoms of menopause, because I know the brain fog, right?
Right, so exactly.
What else would you say are the cognitive symptoms? So then I can help our viewers know how we can tackle those through planning and habit tracking. So I know brain fog. I know I go into the kitchen, stop in mid space and go, why am I here again?
That's pretty much it.
Right. And so I know also, I guess, the stress. I'm not too sure yet. I'm going to visit my general practitioner about hormone levels. And I think, of course, that will affect how your brain functions. So I just thought, for me as a mum of a younger son who's on the autism spectrum, that stress and being overwhelmed was just part of being a mum and, running a household and running content creation. But I also, is it true that stress as well is one of the cognitive symptoms of perimenopause? I just want to confirm first.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It is.
Right. So how do we manage the symptoms that happens to our brain with planning and habit tracking? Well, first of all, brain fog. Try and make sure not to store everything in your brain. So it's like productivity and any other self-care things. Get it out of your head and, as you said, down on paper, because our brain is not made to store the mundane things like pick up the dry cleaning, what to meals to make tonight, when the, you know, your children's school excursion is on, or when you need to meet up a friend. By putting it down on paper, you can be free. You don't have to try and remember everything. All you need to do is refer back to your planner, or if you have your calendar on the wall, if you have one in your kitchen, if you have a little notepad on your refrigerator, then you don't have to try and remember things. So first, planning and putting things down on paper will help alleviate those brain fogs and having to try and remember things. Now, the other thing, of course, is also making sure that it helps you create little list of things to do. So it's important that if you start to find that you have a lot on your to-do list, you need to start minimizing it to release yourself from the stress, the overwhelm. Take everything off your list, put it aside, and put only one thing down on the paper and tackle that. And then that will help you start to manage your stress as well. Remember how I said putting things down on paper? I've got notes, because it's important that I have these, or else going into this lovely conversation with you, Betty, if I didn't have my notes, I would be stressing out. I wouldn't be able to give you the best answers that I can and help out your viewers and those that tune in know how planning, putting things down on paper, can help these symptoms, the exact same symptoms that we are discussing right now, the brain fog, the hot flushes, the things that overwhelm. So it's so important that if you can, you don't have to have, for those of you that do visit my, you know, my channel, you don't have to have the best planners. You can just get a simple notepad and this, you know, if you want a favorite pen or just a pen down from your dollar store. But it's important that you have tools to be able to help you during stressful moments like brain fogs, when you're feeling stressed, when you're feeling like there's overwhelm. So there we go. That just answers in real time, everybody, how you can help combat the cognitive symptoms that do come along with perimenopause and menopause by putting things down on paper and planning things.
I love that answer, because we think that we have to keep everything in our head, and we don't. Yeah. Write it down. If you find that you're forgetting things, write it down. Keep it. It's just, you have so many things, as you said, Marianne, to think about during the course of a day, especially if you're running a business, if you're an executive, if you have children, you have a husband, you're running a home, you can't possibly keep everything in your head. So it is absolutely paramount to make sure that everything that you have, you know, there's no shame in having notes. There's absolutely no shame in having notes. So I absolutely appreciate that.
The big scholars of the times, now they're discovering their notebooks of, you know, poetry, their notebooks of, you know, the scientific formulas, right? So the great minds write down notes. It's important, because you don't want to forget all that great things that do happen in there. And I know later on, you know, with regards to the things that happen with the stress and overwhelm, you don't just have to have your planner for your task and to-do list and the birthdays and the appointments. There are many more uses. Now, of course, I am a paper to planner type of planning person, but it doesn't have to just be on paper. For those of you and the viewers, they can be digital. You can use your phone, take notes. I sometimes send myself a text. So then while I'm out and about, I don't forget things like make sure to put the washing in the dryer. So then I don't forget. Make sure to take the chicken out of the freezer to defrost. So it doesn't just have to be confined to your planner or your paper planner. You can use digital tools as well, like Google Calendar, voice text, make a voice memo, remind me to go and fill up the, you know, fill in the permission note for the son's school excursion, things like that. So just do be mindful for the viewers. If you love to plan digitally, that is also a fantastic way to get things out of your head and down on something else that'll help remember things for you.
I'm so glad you said that, because I, you know, when I watch your videos, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm like some of your viewers. How do you do that? How do you find the time for that? But I love what you say when you write it down or you speak it into your phone and then put it on your planner. And speaking of cognitive, cognitive behavior, there is something to be said for having a pen and paper and taking it from your head and writing it on a piece of paper. And that's why journaling is so important. And we'll talk about that a little later, but I love that you are using both, you're using technology and manual journaling or manually writing and documenting or tracking your tools and your to-dos for the day. I absolutely love that. And I think about how I'm doing it, and I do the same thing. I have my technology, I have my composition notebooks, I have my notes on my computer. And so I'm actually doing the same thing, but yours is just so pretty.
And we have to remember, for those that do see my planner pages, I have been doing it for a long time. So don't be discouraged and see that, you know, the later on when we show examples of how I do use planning as a form of self-care and productivity, that my pages may be overwhelming to a lot of people. But like I said earlier, take a simple blank sheet of paper, just your pencil, your pen, write down on the top of the list your priority of the day. What is it, if nothing else gets done in your day, that you would consider it a win if this one important thing, the thing that matters most to you, not the answering emails, not the, you know, whatever the other mundane things that we think that fills our to-do list, makes us productive. It just makes us look busy, right?
But no, we're not being productive. Ooh, so
there's a difference
love
between
that.
Productivity and business. Yes, Ting, exactly.
Love
so
that.
Important.
That I
whatever
love
that. You do put on your planner page is to what matters most to you, because there's only 24 hours in the day. A lot of it's already been taken up by sleep. For those of us that can sleep, I know. perimenopause, thank you so much. You know,
insomnia is a thing.
Exactly, right? So it's important that for the limited time that we do have during a day with everything else we have to do, put down what matters most.
And you know what? You bring up an interesting point, because if you are losing sleep because of insomnia, then you are going to be forgetful. So that's another reason to write things down. But in addition, which brings up another point, in addition to your different kinds of planners, you've also developed a sleep tracker. So can you discuss the link between the effective planning and improved sleep patterns for women going through menopause and subsequent impact on their mental well-being, and also how you deal with that with your sleep tracker?
Now, for me, I use my sleep tracker as a way to go and measure how much I'm sleeping, when I'm sleeping, so then I can understand my own pattern of why in the morning or during the day I act or react certain ways. So of
beautiful.
Course, we do know that lack of sleep, you know, when you're only getting 3 to 4 hours, it's going to affect the way you perform during the day. You're going to be angry, you're going to be cranky, you're going to react to things instead of have the opportunity to respond to the different things that life throws at you during the day and puts that spanner in your well-planned day, right? So you might have the best well-planned day and then things happen and then you'll have to make sure you're able to execute them. So for me, when I track my sleep, for the moment, yes, I do have very little sleep, but I also do know the importance of napping. So for me, I have the opportunity to nap a little bit, even that 10 minutes. I put my little timer on my Apple Watch and it actually does help boost up the energy a little bit later on. So for those that do, you know, here we are back in the days when we were little, we didn't want to nap. No, I didn't want to nap when we're toddlers. Now I welcome naps. So my sleep tracker allows me to see my progress. So then when I know that the last couple of days I haven't been sleeping well, maybe 3 to 4 hours on average. Of course, that is not good, everybody. And I do know this, and that's, I know this because I track my sleep. Then I know I can plan my day a lot better. I can respond to things rather than react. So if I know the lack of sleep and I do get cranky and, you know, cranky and hungry at the same time, hangry, right? So I'm not going to put pressure on myself on the next couple of days while I catch up on my sleep. So if my to-do list is full to the brim, take it away, start with a blank page and have a look. What's the most important thing? What's the one thing? Done that? What's the next thing? So sleep tracking has been an important and vital tool for me because then I get to see patterns in my sleep. And hopefully, I'm not there yet. Hopefully, then I can manage it a lot better and then start, you know, preparing to sleep at an early time of the night rather than, you know, staying up too late and scrolling my phone. So I think Peter Drucker, a management guru, said,
Peter.
Yep. Well, what gets measured gets managed. So you will see throughout our conversation how different trackers that I have created for myself and then a lot of my viewers has started implementing on their own planning journey, how tracking allows you to measure your progress, also gives you that dopamine hit for those of us that love ticking and, you know, marking things off, that allows you that, you know what, I may have only a little bit of sleep, but it's a lot better than the previous week when on average it was 3 to 4 weeks I put stuff in place to make sure I get those extra 1 to 2 hours and building on that. So sleep trackers are a great way for those on the perimenopausal journey where sleep is a little bit more difficult. Then you can start to go and put actionable steps in place to improve it.
Beautiful. I love that. A lot of people, a lot of women going through menopause struggle to achieve and maintain a healthy work-life balance. Is there an actual planner for that? And if so, how can menopausal women use it to organize some of the challenges they face in terms of work-life balance?
Now, yes, as a homeschooling mom, wife, mother, also want to be an entrepreneur and a creative and artistic person, and then also trying to find time for me, making sure I'm catching up with friends, the house looks clean. How do you manage it all? So as a lover of reader and productivity books, as well as habit tracking books, I have discovered a personal development methodology by Zig Ziglar. So his Wheel of Life methodology, where you focus on 7 key areas. Now, there are different versions of the Wheel of Life. You can have 8 key areas of focus. There's the 10 of life. So whatever it is that is important to you. So in the Wheel of Life, in no particular order, the spiritual, mental, physical, career, finance, family, and social. So I put that on a planner that I use called the Wellbeing Planner page, where you will set habits and routines, simple habits and routines, mind you, to allow you to focus on these 7 key areas. Now, it's important that you don't have to try and do everything, every time, every day, but it allows you to go, you know what? I haven't caught up with my friends for a while. I haven't had a chat to my family for a while because your wheel of life, your well-being planner says that, hey, you've been isolating yourself at home, and we know we thrive with tribe of people that also enjoy the same things we do. Mm-hmm. And so it's important that the wheel of life on my planner page, so we'll show while we're talking, is there's a pie chart, because I'm a visual person. And as you can see from the pie chart there, here's an old example from a previous week that I had. I can clearly see that I haven't been active in, you know, touch base with my friends and family. So the mm-hmm. following week, I'm going to put into place, hey, call a friend, catch up with, you know, someone for coffee. Also, the wheel of life is going to show us that, you know what, you've been neglecting your finance for a long while. And here you are, not only are you stressed because of the perimenopause symptoms, but then you're also being stressed by the finance, and then that's going to, you know, build upon each other. So it's important that creating and finding that balance is something that we plan for. So then we don't turn around in a week's time, in 3 months' time, in a couple of years' time and go, why do I have no friends? Why is my finance a mess? Why is it that, you know, I'm forgetting a lot of things and not building that, sharpening the saw by learning new skills? Or why is it that I have my belly fat? Or why is it that my mind is not at peace? So the well-being planner spread I created for myself, and I didn't know later down the track that it has helped a lot of people who have purchased it create that simple habits and routines that focuses on these seven key areas of focus. You know, it, for you, for some, for our viewers, you can change the headings and the titles, so it doesn't have to be stuck on those seven key areas. Make it whatever works for you. So I do this on a weekly basis rather than on a monthly basis, because things change, right? Or a month's time, we forget, oh, yes, that's right. At the beginning of the new month or at the beginning of the new year, I said I wanted to exercise more. I said I was wanting to eat better. It allows you to pivot on a week-to-week basis, and so then you're not hard on yourself if you do drop the ball a couple of times in any or one or two of those key areas of focus.
Yeah, because life happens, especially when you have family. You can't, you know, things do change from week to week. And I love that, because I have something called the circle of life as well. And that is so, it is so important, because we don't think about those other areas, our spirituality, our finances, in terms of being the holistic person, you know, the holistic being. All of those things take an important role in our lives, and we have to foster those, and you know, not only our immediate relationships, but the relationships with our friends and associates as well. So I absolutely love that you have a tracker for that. And, you know, can you discuss the role of goal setting in creating a sense of purpose and direction for women in menopause? And how can using a planner facilitate this?
Once again, the thoughts down on, you know, paper is so important, because we see it. We remove ourselves, because we're already having so much stress, whether life or the symptoms that do come along with the perimenopausal journey. Stress and overwhelm can help get us stuck in our own head. I've been there for the last 8 months. I've been healing from a mental breakdown where I was just stuck in my own head. Low thoughts, low moments. I'm not good enough. I shoulda, woulda, coulda. Why aren't I a good mom? Why? How can I be a better wife? So by having things in place, and I said earlier, simple habits and routines. Don't put any more pressure on yourself than you already have. So, for example, one of the things to make sure that you do have that balance. So for me, spiritually, what I do is I like to meditate in the morning. I've only discovered meditation, and I do use a guided app for that. So because, you know, I get distracted, I'm in my own head. So I want to make sure that I start the day with a clear mind, lower down my breathing, so then my heart, because we do know when your heartbeat is running fast, it's telling your brain that there's either a risk or you need to fight, flight, or freeze, right? So being able to meditate, and whatever meditation looks like for your viewers and those that are tuning in, it doesn't have to be the breathing, right? Because I thought that was meditation. Meditation could be reading, journaling, doing your favorite hobby like knitting, crocheting, going for a walk.
Walk.
Right? Yeah, because then that is important, that we just think meditation is about the breathing. It's the things that help calm your heart rate, that lets you focus on something. So then, yes, acknowledge the feelings that do come in and acknowledge the thoughts, and then just blow them away and concentrate on your walking, concentrate on your journaling, and concentrate on your meditating. So what simple, and just doing that for 1 minute, right? Doesn't have to be, oh, I've got to meditate for 30 minutes. Then, of course, if there's things you don't want to do, then you don't do it, right? So keep it simple. Things like keeping your brain sharp, because one of those cognitive symptoms is loss of memory, forgetfulness, the verbal stress. You go, what's that word again? Right? So we need to make sure our brain is sharp by reading. So reading doesn't have to be the nonfiction, you know, encyclopedias, and it can be reading your favorite novels and favorite nonfiction books. Keeps your brain active by reading. You get to learn new words. How about learning a new language? Simple things. So it's important, as you said earlier, how do you manage these? How do you create goals? And I know your viewers can link, watch one of, because remember, I binge watched one of your videos, is creating SMART goals. So SMART stands for specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time sensitive. And I'm sure Betty will put a link down in the description below that you can watch that, and she'll explain more, because, you know, I'm sure we have lots more things to talk about. So creating those SMART goals. Don't just say, I want to lose weight, right? You can say, in 9 months' time, I want to lose 3 kilos, or whatever, you know, pounds it is for US viewers. Or I'm going to walk 5 minutes a day. Don't just say, I'm going to start exercising. Mm-hmm. Simple, SMART goals is important. So then you have a sense of achievement when you've done it, rather than, oh, I said I was going to exercise every day this week. We know that's not going to happen. Be realistic. You know that's not going to happen. But if you do skipping, I've seen Betty and I do like the ropeless skipping, do that for 1 to 2 minutes, get your cardio and heart rate up. Then if you achieve that, you have accomplished something that you wouldn't have done yesterday with zero exercise. So it's important that SMART goals, simple goals, and be kind to yourself and give yourself grace for those times that you can't, because we've spoken about it earlier. Life happens. But when that does happen, you've got the next day. Pick it up again. And if all you can do is walk around your backyard, walk around the block, that is a win. Don't think that as a consolation prize. That is a win. So it's important that the viewers know when you are creating those habits and simple routines. And, of course, celebrate them, right? Celebrate those wins. Pat yourself on the back. You know, if the goal is something financial, maybe don't give yourself the reward of spending money. Something else. Do something else. Or if you're trying to lose weight, don't go into a bag of Doritos like sometimes.
Or pizza or cake.
Or a pizza. Yes, very important that the reward that you give yourself when you celebrate your win doesn't derail
No.
those simple habits that you're trying to build.
Also, focusing on affirmations has been touted as a technique that people in general can use to improve their mindset, along with all that you've shared. So, how do you think daily affirmations can be incorporated into a planning routine that positively impacts the mindset of women in menopause?
Now, we spoke about it earlier that we sometimes do get stuck in our own head. And the thing is, I've read that the brain actually doesn't know what's real and what's not, right? So if you feed it things that is not real, the things that, you know, for me, that I'm fat, I don't look good, that I'm not good enough, that's what it's going to start thinking. And the more you focus on something, that's what you're going to start to spot. If you focus on a lot of negative things, you're going to spot all the negative things around you. But guess what? There's also the flip side. If you start having affirmations, you know, little phrases to yourselves. I know Mel Robbins does the high five in the morning in the mirrors. And I know just recently on one of her podcasts, she interviewed Dr. Daniel Amen, and talked about he starts his day by having to writing down, today's going to be a great day. So by having those morning journaling, so for me, my affirmations are my morning journaling. That can be, you know, different ways. You can have a gratitude log. Look for the things that you are grateful and thankful for. Yes. And guess what happens? You start to spot all these beautiful things. Write down, today is going to be a great day. I am good enough. I am worthy. Whatever affirmations you want to have, but make sure that it's not just, you know, the woo-woo stuff, the wishy-washy stuff. Make sure that it relates to you. I know for me, I have discovered that when I do get anxious, when things are going wrong, I start to help recognize it, just go and talk to myself. Marianne, remember that time similar thing happened? You stressed over it for 3 hours, you gave up, and guess what? On the fourth hour, you found the solution. So how about instead of stressing for these 3 hours, do something else. Write your worries down. Write down things that are making you anxious. And then that way, it's out of your head, down on paper. You can see it and you can look at it. How easy is it, Betty, for us to compliment friends of ours that are doubting themselves, right? We tell them,
oh my gosh, yes,
that how good they are, but it's so hard for us to do it because you know why? Because we don't tell it to ourselves.
Yes.
So it's important that we have conversations with ourselves, journaling, writing things down on paper, whether good stuff. I know sometimes for those of us that can't sleep at night because thoughts are whirling in our head, you can write an anxiety log or a worry log where you just blurb out on paper everything you're thinking about. Don't make it all grammatically correct or, you know, paragraphs and sentence, whatever comes to mind, and keep writing. And then if you start to find yourself writing the same things over and over, you've pretty much got everything out of paper, down in paper. Tomorrow I'm going to look for solutions for those, or if there's things that I can't do that's out of my control, I have to be able to acknowledge to let it go.
Get a sticky note, get some sticky notes or some post-its and put affirmations on your mirror. Do that mirror work and have some positive affirmations that you can actually look at yourself in the mirror and say them to yourself each day or however many times throughout the day that you go and look in the mirror at yourself, say those things to yourself.
Exactly. And, you know, and having those little mantras for yourself. Start your day. Today's going to be a great day. I am enough. I'm worthy. I'm thankful for my healthy children. I'm thankful for a job that I like. I'm thankful that I can put food down on the table. They don't have to be all the grandioso gratefulness things. I'm thankful that I have heat during the cold months, that I have air conditionings during the hot months, that I can turn the air conditioning off, when I'm
having a hot flash.
Yes, and then we have money to be able to put a jumper on and a jacket for my husband because it's too cold and I'm too hot. I know Angela and I have talked about that before, that it just husbands or, you know, our partners have to, you know, put a blanket on when we put the air conditioning on. a freeze level.
Yes. I know. That is so funny. But listen, so if you are enjoying this conversation so far, click the button. And I just want to also take this moment to share with you that I've got some exciting things planned for 2024. And if you want to know about it before everybody else does, click the link in my bio and get on my wait list. You can be a part of the menopause movement I'm creating. It takes 2 seconds to click yes. I want you to sign up right now. So sign up, really, right now. Go click the link. Did you do it? Yes? Yay! Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I will see you on the inside. Thank you. And so back to us, Marianne. I am just absolutely loving this conversation with you. And so now I want to talk about habit tracking, because you got a lot on that too. What exactly is habit tracking and why is it important?
Habit tracking is really just a simple way to measure your progress, see how well you're going with the goals that you have set for yourself. If we look at habit tracking as like the stakeholder on the ground, so when life throws things at us, our well-planned day gets derailed, then we can refer back to our habit tracker. So not only is our habit tracker a great way for us to measure our progress, to mark off things that we completed, but it's a place that we can go back to and go, what was that thing I was supposed to do again? You don't have to remember because you have your habit tracker there that says, once you've done, made the bed and washed your face, it's now time to go and do the next thing on your list. So it's like your little stepping stone. For me, my habit tracker is also my little stepping stone to tell me, once you've done this, what's the next thing? James Clear says in his book, Atomic Habits, it's habit stacking. So once I've woken up in the morning, I will write in my morning journal. Once I've written my morning journal, I will do some meditation. Once I've meditated, I'm going to read for 10 minutes. So see how then it helps you create those habits. So then it becomes ingrained. It's like, you know, like nowadays, we don't think about what we need to do to brush our teeth. And that's why they say you get your best ideas in the shower because you're not thinking, what do I have to do next? Oh, yep, shampoo. What's after shampoo? Right? It's become a habit. It's ingrained. It's automatic. So then that is what we want to do when it comes to looking after ourselves and combating those symptoms that do come up with perimenopause is when these things happen, we have a system, a process in place that helps us sleep better, be mindful, putting good food in our body, walking, reading, meditating, all the good stuff that people should do anyway, not just for those on their perimenopausal journey. And I think that's why I may be in a good position because here I am, I didn't even know it, but I've been preparing myself for these couple of years to combat the different things that's going to come along through my perimenopausal journey. And so, wow, thank you so much for helping me recognize that, hey, these are the things that's kind of come up. These are the things that can help you along the way.
Do you also track your cycles?
Well, now I created a period tracker recently because I have learned from you that postmenopause or menopause is actually when you haven't had your period for 366 or 367 days.
365 or 366 on a leap year.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So it's that. The next day that you have, so it has to be important that, right. You know, if you get your period of 6 months into that, that you've got to start over again. So it's all really important that I also have a tracker for that. So that is also something that I've started to make sure that I am noting down. Nope, none today. Nope, none today. Nope, none today. So then, of course, if there's 365 or none today, then that 366 is, I'm in my post-menopause. So I think I'm on my fourth month. I have tracked that no period. So it's a long battle, I hear. So, but I'm putting in stuff in place to make sure that I'm able to manage it and I am not stressing. And habit trackers allows you to do that, because if we look at our habit trackers, and again, we'll probably put a visual of my one. This is going to be too much for a lot of people. Keep it simple. If you're starting to track your habits for the first time, only 1 to 2, right? Don't look at mine, because I might be on my chapter 25 of habit tracking and you've just started on chapter 1. So habit tracking allows you to make sure that you are putting things in place to help combat the different symptoms that do come along with perimenopause. If we look at habit tracking as like the stakeholder on the ground, so when life throws things at us, our well-planned day gets derailed, then we can refer back to our habit tracker. So not only is our habit tracker a great way for us to measure our progress, to mark off things that we completed, but it's a place that we can go back to and go, what was that thing I was supposed to do again? You don't have to remember, because you have your habit tracker there that says, once you've done, made the bed and washed your face, it's now time to go and do the next thing on your list. So it's like your little stepping stone. For me, my habit tracker is also my little stepping stone to tell me, once you've done this, what's the next thing? James Clear says in his book, Atomic Habits, it's habit stacking. So once I've woken up in the morning, I will write in my morning journal. Once I've written my morning journal, I will do some meditation. Once I've meditated, I'm going to read for 10 minutes. So see how then it helps you create those habits. So then it becomes ingrained. It's like, you know, like now, nowadays, we don't think about what we need to do to brush our teeth. And that's why they say you get your best ideas in the shower, because you're not thinking, what do I have to do next? Oh, yeah, shampoo. What's after shampoo, right? It's become a habit. It's ingrained. It's automatic. So then that is what we want to do when it comes to looking after ourselves and combating those symptoms that do come up with perimenopause, is when these things happen, we have a system, a process in place that helps us sleep better, be mindful, putting good food in our body, walking, reading, meditating, all the good stuff that people should do anyway, not just for those on their perimenopausal journey. And I think that's why I may be in a good position, because here I am, I didn't even know it, but I've been preparing myself for these couple of years to combat the different things that's going to come along through my perimenopausal journey. And so, wow, thank you so much for helping me recognize that, hey, these are the things that's kind of come up. These are the things that can help you along the way.
And it's so important for us to be prepared for perimenopause and for the menopause experience. And that's why I do what I do, because it's extremely, extremely important for you to know what's coming, so you can prepare for it. And having a tracker or having some kind of planner already set up for you that you're working on and working through is extremely, extremely important for those times. What advice do you have for women who are new to tracking habits, and especially in terms of potential benefits for managing their menopausal challenges? What would you say to them?
So that acronym of KISS, keep it simple, very, you know, is
sweetie,
really
sweetie.
Thank you. That is a better, yes, that is a better way. Kiss. Keep it simple, sweetie. Sexy mamas. How's that? There we go. Keep it simple, sexy hot mamas. So really, really important is, what's the first thing that you would like to, you know, change or build better habits around? So if you know, if you're, I've seen one of your videos about, you know, a lot of women ask you, how do you get rid of belly fat? You can't get rid of belly fat if you're sitting on the couch eating bags of chips and lollies and treats, right? So what are the first things that you want to do? So your habit tracker then will allow you to go and put, you know what, let's put some, just walk 5 to 10 minutes each and every day. It's simple. Put your running shoes on or walking shoes on, and then wait, and then have that as your only thing on your habit tracker. Of course, there are things, other things that you're going to do in your day-to-day life, but those habits are important to build upon, because if you try and do it all at the same time, oh, well, I need to track my sleep. I need to go and walk more. I need to make sure I'm putting good food in my body, and I need to also journal and affirmations. That is going to put more pressure on yourself already that the symptoms do put on you. Now, as you said earlier, your ebook, The 3 Keys to Understanding
Maximizing Menopause.
Maximizing menopause. So I have that in my planner, and you know, as you can see here, I have it in my planner. So it's one of the things I refer back to. So mindset, what sort of things can I put in place when it comes to my mindset and giving myself, moving myself from fixed to growth mindset? What sort of things can I put in my body that's going to ensure that I am eating healthily? And movement, what sort of things can I incorporate in my day? So even if we start with those 3 simple things, 3 simple habits, and your ebook is going to help give ideas for the women watching now, and, you know, of course, those that also do support the women in their life going through perimenopause, or what sort of things that they can help with. So, of course, you know, if your partners, husbands, or your friends and family can help out, be the accountable partners for when you're walking, making sure that we're putting and cooking the, you know, nutritional meals, and making sure that for those maybe, you know, that we know that our life when we wake up in the morning is going to be hectic, maybe partners that can help support that, make us healthy breakfast, you know, things like that. So let's start off with 3 simple habits that tackle those 3 key understandings that Betty has in her ebook will be a wonderful start.
I love that. Thank you so much, Marianne. And, you know, I actually, that brings me to my last question. What advice would you have for the menopausal woman who finds the blank pages of a journal or a planner or a tracker just to be boring or even daunting? You know, we know that staring at a blank page is like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to say. So what advice would you have for those women?
Go from a place of joy. What is it that brings you joy?
So for me,
I love color on my pages. I've seen a lot of planners who want to keep it minimal, where it's just pen to paper or just one simple highlighter, or as you said earlier, those sticky notepads. So you can actually take those little sticky notepads and put it in your journal and just have it as a memory keeping. Planning doesn't have to be just the boring old to-do list and tasks and appointments. If you are like me, that do love all the stationery and that brings you joy, do that. If that is not you, you can also just keep it to a bullet point. Or you know what you can do? Get a pretty planner. So if you have a beautiful planner with a nice, colorful cover page, get your favorite pen. It's something that you put on your bedside table, so then when you wake up in the morning, you can write down everything that's in your head or have a look at what's coming up, or on the other side of the day in the evening to be write down what you're grateful for, the worries, the anxieties. Get it out of your head so it's not whirling in there, so then you can get some sleep and then help you sleep better. Because when we sleep better, we can then manage and tackle the day better on the other side. So whatever brings you joy. So what will work for someone else? You might go and go, oh, Betty, Marianne, I don't know if I have time to do all that embellishing. Remember, for me, I find the time because it's my me time. It's my put on the oxygen mask on me time, because if this brings me joy, then guess who's going to benefit from it? All those other people around me, and most importantly, myself.
Yes, yes, yes. I love that. I absolutely love that. Oh my gosh. Yes. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Marianne. This has been amazing.
Thank you. It's been a wonderful joy because it's really put my planning for productivity and self-care in an even more important light, because it's also actually helping me prepare myself for the journey that, because we won't know. That's the thing with menopause, isn't it? We don't know how long the journey will take. Some
That's
people start
right.
earlier. Some people doesn't finish until a lot later. So this is a journey. And so it's important to build and create those simple habits and me time and self-care time. And so I really appreciate that we have given women like myself this platform, your YouTube channel, your website, your ebook, and the exciting things that's coming up in the future of Crazy Sexy Menopause, that we have a place to give ourselves opportunity to learn the things that unfortunately those women before us didn't know. And so thank you for Betty Vargas and Crazy Sexy Menopause and what you do. I really do appreciate it so much.
Oh, Marianne, thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, that means the world to me. And thank you so much for joining me today. This has been absolutely amazing. And I want you to know you can connect with Marianne. Marianne, you're everywhere. You're on YouTube, you're on Instagram, you're on Facebook, and they're all at MarianneCresp.com, right?
Yes. And Betty, if you will allow me, for your viewers that do want to purchase any of my planner printable download for the next 3 days, they can use the code Betty10. That's capital BETTE10 discount code. And if you do visit MarianneCresp.com, you can get 10% on any of the planner insert printable download to help those that do want to start putting better habits, planning and productivity and that self-care in their own planning journey. So Betty10 for discount code at MarianneCresp.com,
and all very the details nice. Will be in the description.
You're
very
welcome.
Nice. And also we'll have that information and the correct spelling of both of our names in the description, so you won't miss a thing. Okay. Thank you so very much, Marianne. And thank you, everyone, for joining me today. If you have enjoyed this content as much as I have, subscribe if you haven't done so already. And by all means, share this information with your friends and family and whomever, co-workers, whomever. It would certainly help me to reach more women searching for menopausal support. So, as I always say, see you next time. And always remember, it's your life. Live it well.